Hello. This talk is about Hatshepsut, the queen of Egypt who became the king of Egypt in the 15th century BC during the 18th dynasty. She ruled between around 1479 to 1458 BC, but I have to say those dates are extremely approximate for a whole variety of reasons. It is impossible for us to calculate absolute dates for Egyptian history at that time. We can only do approximations, and I'm not going to go into the details of why it's not possible to be exact in this talk, because I've explained it elsewhere. This is the 18th dynasty in the series of royal dynasties of Egyptian history, roughly in the middle of overall pharaonic Egyptian history, and it's the climax of Egypt's power and wealth, and that's why I'm writing a book about it called The Climax of Egypt. And it's an absolutely fascinating period because it's really one of the first great historical eras in world history. At the time we're talking about, if you were to look at Mycenaean Greece or Minoan Crete or other civilizations, it's really almost impossible to construct any kind of narrative chronology history about how the place was ruled, certainly in the Mycenaean and Minoan context. We don't know anything about the kings at all. Egypt has something that approximates to a historical record, although it's mostly very tendentious propaganda type information that comes from royal sources. But it does make it possible to have an idea of what really happened. Hatshepsut was the member of this extraordinary dynasty that began with somebody called Thutmose, who in the end of the 16th century BC managed to expel the Hyksos, who were the Asiatic rulers who controlled Egypt in the northern part, in the Delta area, and had effectively split the country. Thutmose expels the Hyksos, and that establishes the great 18th dynasty royal trope that this is the family entitled to rule, because they had expelled the invaders and reunified the country. And that's something they trumpet from the beginning to the end. Now, the dynasty lasts for a couple of hundred years. It ends up with a certain bloodline character, Tutankhamun, who everybody's heard of, who was succeeded by a vizier called Ai, who may or may not have been a relative, and then a general called Horemheb, who transitions, if you will, the end of the 18th dynasty into the 19th, which he founds. Now, during the 18th dynasty, Egypt really does achieve an astonishing level of power in the region and an exceptional amount of wealth, much of which is poured into building monuments and tombs. Now, let's look at Hatshepsut more specifically. Her name, Hatshepsut, means the foremost amongst noble women. It's feminized with the T on the end, and otherwise it would just mean the foremost among nobles. And if that sounds like a very prescient name to you, it wasn't. It was a name used by other queens and princesses and was generally widely known in Egypt. I suppose if you wanted an English equivalent, it would be, a modern equivalent, it would be prima donna or first lady, something like that. Some sort of colloquial equivalent would fit in that context. So Hatshepsut is born to Thutmose I. Thutmose I is the third ruler of the 18th dynasty, and she is born to his principal queen, Thutmose, and that's very important in Hatshepsut's story. Thutmose I also had a lesser queen called Mutnofret, by whom she has a son known to history as Thutmose II. And the family, the 18th dynasty royal family, is very keen on the idea of containing power within the royal line. And that's a way of keeping others out. And if you think that sounds like the potential for incest, well, you'd be right, because Thutmose I marries Thutmose II to his half-sister, Hatshepsut. I've got a picture of Thutmose II's body here, or his head at any rate, and you can see there that he has the overbite, the congenital overbite, which is a characteristic of the 18th dynasty royal line. And in fact, if I flick through this book while I'm talking to you, I can go all the way back to Thutmose Nefertari, who is the sister queen of Thutmose. And there is Thutmose Nefertari's, or the probable Thutmose Nefertari's body, and you can see there the extremely prominent overbite as well. That's from the mummies found in the royal cache in the late 19th century. So a very, very interesting aspect to identifying the bodies and the line to which they belong. So Hatshepsut is therefore combined into a half-sibling marriage, and she has a daughter by her half-brother called Neferu-Re, which is very important to Hatshepsut, but it's even more important that she didn't bear him a son. Now, Thutmose I, her father, had been a very successful general. He'd also done quite a lot of building at the great temple complex at Karnak, which is contributing to the great tradition of building at the Karnak temple, and he'd certainly erected some obelisks there, one of which still stands. Now, this is all very well and good, and had Thutmose II lived, there really wouldn't have been much more to say about Hatshepsut. She would have existed alongside him, and perhaps become the Dowager Queen later on, but that wasn't to happen. Thutmose II had had a son, known to history as Thutmose III, by a lesser wife. Now, this is extremely significant in Hatshepsut's story, because Thutmose II dies young, leaving Hatshepsut a widow as a relatively young woman. Now, she and her brother may well only have been in her their teens when they married, and that's something I think that is, I'm just getting slightly off the point here, but I think it's worth bearing in mind with Egyptian history that a lot of these prominent characters came to power as teenagers or children, and a lot of what they did was as very young adults, and I think it's quite important to bear that in mind. We have no idea actually how long Thutmose II reigned. Some people think he only ruled for 3 or 4 years. Some people would give it just over 10. It's a mark of the imprecise data that we've got that it's really impossible to say. Nevertheless, what happens to begin with is a fairly conventional arrangement. Thutmose III is only a couple of years old at this stage, but he still becomes the king. And Hatshepsut becomes a regent for him, so she oversees her half-nephew's accession to the throne. And this goes on for 6 to 7 years. Now, what we've got no idea about is whether Hatshepsut was formulating her ideas during that period, whether she had a long master plan, or whether it was something, what she did, was something she came up with later on. All we know is that by the 7th regnal year, she declares herself to be king alongside Thutmose III. So they are co-rulers, but of course he is only a child. She is presumably by now an adult woman and must have been well on into her 20s, I would have thought, at the very least, late 20s perhaps. Now, here we come up straight against a problem for us in understanding all this terminology, because a great deal is made about the fact that Hatshepsut has made herself king. And I find this actually quite frustrating, because that's all to do with our translations of these terms, and that there aren't really exact equivalents. One has to get one's head around the fact that Egyptian is a totally different type of language, and many forms of expressions are really quite different. Where we would have a word in English, they would perhaps have an explanatory phrase. So the symbol for what we translate as a king is a sedge plant, and the word is Nisw, we spell it NSW, that's the transliteration of it, and it means literally he of the sedge plant, because that was a symbol of Upper Egypt, and by Upper Egypt that doesn't necessarily mean Upper Egypt up the Nile, it means Upper Egypt in terms of the spiritual sense of kingship and being a ruler. It's much better translated really as ruler. And because it was traditionally associated with men, it comes with male attributes. But what that means is that anyone, including a woman, who declares herself to be ruler of Egypt, has to adopt the title Nesu along with the male type attributes. Not because she's trying to turn herself into a man, literally, but because that's just the nature of the concept of ruling. In Egyptian, there is no idea of the queen regnant, the queen who rules in her own right, like Mary Tudor or Elizabeth I of England. These two queens, the daughters of Henry VIII, ruled in their own right. They didn't have to be married to a king to rule. That's the queen consort, which is a completely different idea. So today in modern England, Queen Elizabeth II rules in her own right. Her mother, Queen Elizabeth, the queen mother, was a queen consort. It did not rule in her own right. She didn't rule at all. So we have that different idea of the queen. In Egypt, they don't. There is the queen consort, of course, but the queen ruling, the queen regnant, not really. Now, if you go back to the Middle Kingdom, there is a queen called Sobekneferu, who makes herself a king, and she experiments with this idea. And you see in Sobekneferu the first time a queen who, queen king, who experiments with dressing up in the costume of an Egyptian king, a male ruler. And it's quite obvious that it's very fluid. This is vague, and I think a great mistake is to believe that there is somehow an absolute answer to these things, or that when you're looking at Egypt, you are looking at, in Hatshepsut's case, you are looking at a clearly defined plan, a whole ideological basis to how she ruled, that it's all set out. I'm not sure that that's true at all. She's finding her way through a new situation. For the Egyptians, there was very much the idea of the male-female concept, male-female composite in kingship. So the king and the queen form the two halves of the monarchical image. And you see that very clearly in the dyad statues of kings and queens. For example, later in the dynasty with Amenhotep III and T, but that's by no means the only one that you get. And this is an important idea for the male in Egypt, for the idea of ruling, that it is made up of these male and female halves. But when a woman takes power, it's a completely different context, and the Egyptians didn't have a very clear idea of how to deal with this, because a woman couldn't marry outside the royal family. The widowed Hatshepsut can't look outside the 18th dynasty royal family to find a husband to bring in, because he would represent a huge threat to the dynastic integrity. Plus, she doesn't want to share power outside, and she is in the process of developing a very clear ideology of her own entitlement to rule, her personal entitlement to rule, which I'll just come on to in a second. So Hatshepsut is struggling to find her way through this because she can't marry a king, bring in a male to share this with her. She has to put the male-female composite within herself. So she is the male and female half of the idea of ruling all within her and her alone. Now that is a time bomb, because where's it going to go? Since she can't marry again and she hasn't got a son, there is obviously an issue. But for the moment, Hatshepsut seems to set that to one side. What Hatshepsut does is that she goes hell for leather to establish the myth of her predestination. Now, she does there's a great deal of this on the reliefs that are carved in her name, and she shows herself as the daughter of Amun. And that's completely compatible, as far as she's concerned, with her entitlement to rule in the guise of a male ruler. She finds all sorts of ways to adapt feminized titles. Now, she's not the first person to do this, and the notion of feminizing titles for existing queens was already established. But if you take, for example, the title Nebtahwi, which means Lord of the Two Lands, which is the opposite sides of the Nile, by simply taking the Nib, which is a lord, and feminizing it with a T, you get Nebet Tawi, the Lady of the Two Lands. Or you might really say She Lord of the Two Lands. Perhaps that's in fact a better translation of the term. And what we find with Hatshepsut is an almost erratic use of these male and female. Now, partly it could be because people are the masons, the artisans are uncertain of how to represent her in these contexts, but it could also be that she is herself trying to create an ongoing ambivalence, that it could be one or the other. One of the most interesting variations on this theme is that because she is determined to show her entitlement, her descent, she at one point depicts her mother Ames as having been impregnated by the god Amun, who has come in the guise of Thutmose I. So this is another sort of central concept in the dynastic generations. The way they go on is that Amun is the person who is impregnating the queen, and he does so in the guise of the existing king. And Hatshepsut is extremely keen on this idea because, of course, it shows that she was the person who was entitled to be king. She also goes through the interesting process of even transferring those male or female versions of the titles to Thutmose I. And that is, she's trying to normalise it, if you like, amongst other people, so that, in other words, it didn't matter whether you were male or female. As a king of Egypt, you ruled within this self-contained male-female concept within yourself. And that all supports Hatshepsut's campaign. Hatshepsut belonged to a dynasty of kings, many of whom posed as were warrior pharaohs, and that also presents Hatshepsut with a little bit of a problem. How is she going to present herself as a warrior pharaoh? She was always facing a potential existential crisis because she's got Thutmose III, who's growing up in the background. And I might point out, she dates her regnal years right back to his accession, as if they both become kings at the same time. His remorseless growing up means that lying out ahead is the time at which he will become an adult and may challenge her. He's kept very much in the background. He's going to go on to become one of Egypt's greatest warrior pharaohs, or you could say most ruthless warrior pharaohs. Hatshepsut can't really afford to leave the country on a campaign because she might find her power. If she was to walk off and go and fight a war in Asia or Nubia, there's always the possibility that a faction around the young Thutmose III would place him on the throne and push her out. So she does seem to be involved in some warfare, and there certainly are some campaigns during her reign, but nothing like as prominent as there are later. One interesting point is that there's a graffito by a member of her entourage called T-T-Y, male, in this case, and he leaves it on an island near Aswan, and he refers to having seen him go into battle, and he means Hatshepsut, but of course, by calling her him, this gets round the contradiction in having a female warrior pharaoh. But to what extent she fought, we really don't know. Hatshepsut would never have been able to establish and consolidate her control on power in Egypt had it not been for the active and willing support of a number of acolytes, very important acolytes. One of them is the architect Inini, whose career inscription survives, and he was very keen on the fact that Hatshepsut had rewarded him and given him high office, and he makes a very clear distinction in terms of describing Hatshepsut as governing the nation while Thutmose III just ruled. And of course, Thutmose III is a child at that stage. But the most important of all is a man called Senenmut. Senenmut rises to become a sort of principal architect, engineer, artist, steward of almost everything imaginable under Hatshepsut, and he quite clearly adored Hatshepsut, was, I would say, bordering on being infatuated by her. Now, he is a man of modest origins. He has a father called Ramos, who was a Zab. And a Zab is a word for someone of high status, good family, but it's a very nebulous term that rather blankets over the fact that he clearly was a man of no real significance at all, didn't hold any kind of high office. And there is Senenmut's mother, Hatnefer. Now, he ends up building a tomb for them. His parents and his siblings feature in his own extremely elaborate tomb, memorial chapel, bigged up, whereas there's no reference to any wife or family of his own. And you can draw your own conclusions about that. And I'm not going to get into what is a complicated context here, but I think it's legitimate to speculate that Senenmut was a man who was quite content to be without a partner of his own, that he was probably entranced by Hatshepsut and the opportunity to be in her orbit and the spectacular opportunities, if you will, to do whatever he liked with art and architecture with her blessing. He was clearly a highly creative man who had been given the chance to do whatever he liked. And so he's very proud of himself. He talks a lot about how he was the great favourite, that he was he was better than anybody else, he knew more than other people, and he taught himself, it had all come out of his own mind, that he's absolutely the epicentre of Hatshepsut's attention, and she gives him huge privileges. And one of the things that he creates for her is a rebus statue, or rebus motifs, and a rebus being where you realise a word in visual form. So her her throne name was Maatkare, which is, I suppose, order in the soul of Re. It's you can translate it a number of different ways, and it consists of three symbols, which is Maat, the figure of the goddess Maat, which is Maat is a sense of primeval order. Ka is the soul, and Re is the sun. And he creates statues which show these symbols all being held. And he also had been Neferu Re's nurse. That's a word that is used by males and females in Egyptian contexts, a very privileged high status position within the court. And he produces a lot of block statues, and block statues, him sitting down, containing, if you will, Neferu Re. And that marks out his intense intimacy with Hatshepsut and this inner circle, this very tight inner privileged circle. And it's Senenmut who is the main player behind Hatshepsut's magnificent memorial mortuary temple at Deir el-Bahari, known as Jaisa-Jaisa-Ru, Holy of Holies. And this extravagant structure, which is today one of the most prominent places on the West Bank at Thebes, is the crowning glory of Hatshepsut's career.
Thank you.
Hatshepsut's temple at Deir el-Bahari sits at the foot of the cliffs, facing directly opposite Karnak on the other side of the Nile. It wasn't, strictly speaking, an original architectural concept. It's a series of courts, the upper ones reached by ramps, and at the back, shrines and temples right up at the top, including Hatshepsut's own mortuary temple, and also a couple of others as well. Now, the building is skeletal today. Magnificent restoration work, but you have very little sense, really, of the statues that were there, the trees, the plants, the decorations around it. It's sat very close to the Temple of Mentuhotep II from the 11th dynasty, which lay just a few yards to the south. And that was architecturally very similar. And it's quite obvious that what had happened at Deir el-Bahari is we've got a development of that idea, and it becomes a showcase for Hatshepsut's career and life. And it is truly overwhelming to walk up to it today, but it's even more staggering to look at if you walk up round the cliffs up to the top and look over the top. I'm not even sure if you're still allowed to do that. I've done that two or three times, and it is just overwhelming to look down upon the terraces of Hatshepsut's temple from above. Now, in here is where she sets out the ideological basis of her rule, celebrating her father's achievements and also her own achievements. And the crowning one of those for her was the voyage to Punt. They land probably down somewhere on the Ethiopian coast, where all sorts of exotic goods like myrrh trees could be obtained. Very, very complicated to get to, because it involved moving the boats and the manpower all the way across the Egyptian desert to the Red Sea before they could sail down there. And although Hatshepsut makes an enormous amount about the trip to Punt, it's a trading expedition of a type that had in fact happened before in Egyptian history and would continue afterwards, so it's by no means unique. And also, if you think about it, the sheer struggle of moving boats and the necessary manpower across the Red Sea means that there's a limit to what you could have brought back, and it involved a number of troops, actually, which shows you that when they go to Punt, meet the King of Punt, the Queen of Punt being particularly morbidly obese, something that was a source of huge fascination to Hatshepsut sculptors, because they made a very detailed representation of the Queen of Punt for the reliefs at Deir el-Bahari. The fact that there are several dozen soldiers that go along, at the very least, just shows you that the Egyptians were there to enforce themselves on the people of Punt and to bring this stuff back. And it's a huge occasion for Hatshepsut. I mean, she's absolutely delighted, so proud of the fact that this stuff has been brought back. And, of course, the temple itself was decorated with a lot of the materials. Now, the building is going to have something of a checkered history, but it is absolutely the showcase for Hatshepsut and Senenmut. Hatshepsut's work at Karnak was extremely important to her. She was the one who was responsible for establishing the Opet festival, which involved a procession that ran between the temple of Karnak, carrying the cult statue of Amun and the precinct of Mut, down to the temple of Luxor every year. And there were a series of way stations for the bark shrine to be rested in, and one of those appears to have been dismantled in later years by the pharaoh Ramesses II and installed in the court of his extension to the Temple of Luxor. And the reason we know it was Hatshepsut's is that his masons forgot to defeminize some of the titles, indicating that it was her who had originally been responsible. But much the most important visible relic of Hatshepsut's work at Karnak today are the obelisks. Now, she erected at least two pairs of obelisks there. She may have erected three. When you hunt through all the evidence, it's a little bit ambivalent, in fact, a bit ambiguous. It's not quite clear what had gone on there. And she talks about she describes the carrying of a couple of the obelisks up to Karnak. The ones that are the most interesting are the ones erected in the 15th or 16th year. They were 30 metres high. One has fallen down since then, but one still stands, making it the tallest standing obelisk in Egypt and probably the greatest relic of Hatshepsut's reign on the east bank of the Nile. And it certainly would have been visible from her new temple. The pair of them would have been with their tops plated with electrum, glistening in the sunshine, particularly as the sun went down in the west. You'd have been able to see the obelisks gleaming on the other side of the Nile at Karnak. And these obelisks, or the standing one at any rate, are fascinating because in the reliefs on them, she talks in some detail about her aspirations for these monuments, the significance of them, how important they were to her, how epic they were. And she, on the inscriptions on one of the bases, there's quite a famous passage which is refers to her. She says her, well, so the translation goes, her mind is going to and fro about wondering what the people of the future will think when they look upon her monument. And that was something I was quite interested by, because I found this phrase constantly repeated, or versions of it, and I was interested to find out what the Egyptian really said. It took me a very long time to find it, actually. But it's a colloquial term, it-imt. It's a term that was not clear 100 years ago or more, because James Breasted was unable to translate it. He didn't know what to do with it. And it seems to be a term that refers to erratic movement, literally erratic movement. And it's become, or it had become, therefore used for erratic movement within the brain, a kind of metaphorical depiction of your mind going all over the place. So to and fro, it could also mean my mind was all over the place, or I was totally undecided. But even then, I'll be perfectly honest, if you look at Alan Gardner's paper on the little short article about this phrase, he uses the word deplorable to describe the vagaries of translating Egyptian. He's discussing the specific phrase. It's just something not wholly certain about what it really means. And this is so often the case with Egyptian. Something in a translation that looks quite emphatic, unequivocal. Nine times out of ten, you look up the Egyptian and really look at all the potential meanings, that there may be many of them, and also it becomes obvious that often it's just simply not certain. A lot of these translations are actually just guesses. Sound guesses, perhaps, in some cases, but open to a lot of different interpretations. Anyway, the obelisks, there they are, and that's something that is extremely important for Hatshepsut. And we are getting on in her reign now, into her 15th, 16th year. Now, what happens towards the end of Hatshepsut's reign is a very difficult problem. Senenmut had disappeared after the 16th regnal year of the reign. We have no idea what happened to him, except that subsequently his tomb was desecrated and he seems never to have been buried in it. Now, that's not uncommon for people of high office in Egypt. There seems to have been an awful lot of rivalry and jealousy. And I do think in this context it's important to think of some other parallels. One has to bear in mind that within the hothouse, the intensity of a royal court, where everything depended on obtaining royal patronage and position, that was the only way you were going to get wealth for your family and status. If you've got one person or just a few people who are completely monopolizing royal patronage and attention, you can get a huge amount of jealousy. And let's not forget that Senenmut was a commoner. There's no suggestion that he had any other connection to the royal family. There must have been plenty of members of the extended royal family who saw this man dominating Hatshepsut's attention, entranced by her, she perhaps placing all her trust in him, a very close relationship of a type I think we can all imagine what it may have consisted of. There is a scurrilous graffiti that seems to show a ruler of ambiguous gender having intercourse with or being entered by from behind by a male, and that is sometimes be taken to be a representation of Senenmut having some sexual power over Hatshepsut. I think that's probably much too literal an interpretation, not only of the graffiti, but also by the graffiti artist, him or herself. I suspect that this is a relationship where both Hatshepsut was entirely easy with this relationship with Senenmut, a male very close to her, but not a sexual partner, and he was the kind of man for whom this sort of relationship with a woman was what he wanted and suited his inclinations. You know, you could spend hours arguing and talking about it, but he's gone. And you see, if you go look at the Russian royal family, and Rasputin is the obvious comparison, there is somebody, not that he was an artist or anything, but he's extremely close to the Tsarina. There is this man, absolutely hermetically sealed within the Tsarina's close circle. And of course, he ends up being assassinated by members of the extended Russian royal family and other people who are hugely jealous, enraged by his proximity to power and patronage. And if you take it in the Roman Empire, Septimius Severus, the emperor, had a praetorian prefect called Plautianus, who also completely monopolises and dominates the emperor's attention, and Septimius Severus's son, Caracalla, sees to Plautianus's murder. So this sort of thing happens, and I don't think we should be particularly surprised. And it must have, although we do not know that it happened to Senenmut, but I have to say I think it's quite possible. And if it did, it would have begun down the process of diminishing Hatshepsut's power. Let's not forget that anybody within the royal circle at that time would have been able to see Hatshepsut getting older, and they would have been able to see Thutmose III growing up. There visibly is the new power. And if you're interested in power and patronage, you are going to be looking to the future. So I think it's entirely plausible to expect that the young Thutmose III, willingly or through no fault of his own, is becoming the epicentre of a new faction. People who see the future in his rule, the dynamic, because he certainly was a dynamic individual, and that is completely apparent from his rule. This is the man of the future. Hatshepsut is yesterday. Plus, where is Hatshepsut going to go? She hasn't got a son. She can't disinherit Thutmose III. If she murdered him, which she could have done, she would have created probably a civil war and a complete breakdown in Egyptian power. She's established this fantastic myth about her predestination as the daughter of Amun. But because she has not married, again, because she can't, because she doesn't have an heir, the only thing she might have done is marry Neferu Re to Thutmose III. And if that happened, and it just might have done, Neferu-Re doesn't last. She disappears too. And she was obviously destined for some power because Hatshepsut gives her a title. But this, it goes nowhere. So Hatshepsut is constantly having to turn back on the past. And what she does is she spends a lot of time developing a tomb in the Valley of the Kings. And she had a more than one tomb, but and she goes through a process of elaborating them. It's KV20 is likely to be the one in the Valley of the Kings that is the one that she not only has for herself, but also for Thutmose I, for her father, giving up one of her own sarcophagi to be converted for Thutmose I's use so that they can be buried together. Now, the truth is that neither Thutmose I's body is not known, and Hatshepsut's body is not known with any certainty. Some people think it's the remains of a rather overweight woman found in the tomb of her nurse, and that might be the case, but it's frankly a bit tenuous and doesn't really help us anyway with the story. What we have is an inscription from Thutmose III, which states his sole rule to have begun in the 22nd regnal year. This stela, which comes from Marmont, not that far from Thebes, is the only evidence for Hatshepsut's death. Now, you will find it said in books that Hatshepsut died in the 22nd regnal year on the basis of this inscription. It says no such thing. It doesn't mention Hatshepsut. It mentions Thutmose III's sole reign beginning from that point, or implies it. Now, that is therefore by default a likely evidence for the fact that Hatshepsut had died at that point, but I'm just pointing out that it doesn't actually say that. And this is what has to happen with a lot of Egyptian historical evidence, is that you have to take a plausible inference. So what does happen to Hatshepsut? The answer is we have absolutely no idea when or how she died. She may have been by this stage only in her late 30s, she may have been into her 40s. A natural death is entirely possible. So also is bumping her off. Let's face it, when she died in the 22nd regnal year, Thutmose III is in his early 20s. He must have become a little frustrated by this stage about taking over, being able to do what he wanted. Although he always featured in monuments alongside Hatshepsut, but very much in a sort of subordinate way. He's there because she wanted to legitimate the idea of her and him being co-rulers, co-kings, but he's not really someone with any obvious identity. He's undoubtedly marginalised. Hatshepsut, however, had done nothing to harm him, and she had evidently also done nothing to inhibit his training and education. He had begun out training in the priesthood, actually, which means that he seems to have been literate, something he talks about later on. She'd actually done Egypt an enormous favour. She had, if you like, insulated the country from the potential instability resulting from the rule by a child, had it only been Thutmose III who was a king, which would have depended on nobles or advisers ruling in his stead, or a dowager queen who wasn't available, his own mother, not available to rule. So Hatshepsut took over that role. She nurtures, or protects him at any rate. When she becomes king, she continues that insulation. It may have suited her purposes very well, but the result is that by the 22nd regnal year, Thutmose III is a healthy adult, capable of ruling, and Hatshepsut shuffles off this mortal coil at an extremely convenient moment, which could have been purely coincidental, or it could have been that she was definitively removed at Thutmose III's behest, or by those who wanted to see him in control of the country. And that's the end of Hatshepsut's reign. She's gone. It's some time, actually, before Thutmose III begins the process of desecrating Hatshepsut's monuments. And he comes up against one of the consequences, if you will, of her ambivalent male-female identity within the concept of kingship. Because the statues of her are evidently a woman dressed as a king, he can't simply stick his own name on those monuments, and therefore he has to have them destroyed. Now, to what extent this is bitterness, to what extent it is just simply trying to delete this embarrassing episode, if that's how it was seen, of this woman usurping the notion of the male ruler and trying to turn it into this male-female concept enshrined within herself, we simply don't know. One of the other consequences is that I mentioned Senenmut's stuff all being desecrated, except that Thutmose III built his own temple next to Hatshepsut's, and in there are statues of Senenmut that are not destroyed. So it's possible that Senenmut's name was hacked out by others. Frankly, it's all very vague, apart from the utterly deliberate smashing up of statues at Deir el-Bahari, where they're pulverised and thrown into pits, which has made it possible to reconstruct some of them, ironically. Even more ironically, at Karnak, Thutmose III can't get rid of the obelisks. Perhaps they were simply too difficult to lower, so he has them walled up, and the result is that he ends up protecting their reliefs. So the standing obelisk of Hatshepsut today is in exceptionally good condition for that very reason. Later on, Hatshepsut will be obliterated from the royal records, and that is something that Thutmose III begins the process of, because he has Hatshepsut's likeness or names removed from the reliefs, and this sometimes ends up with some quite incongruous, out-of-context scenes as a result in the Temple of Deir el-Bahari. And he is inclined also to put Thutmose I's name down rather than his in order to replace Hatshepsut's. So Hatshepsut, however, does seem to survive all the way down to the late priest Manetho, who wrote out in Greek all his lists of dynasties. And there is somebody called Amesis allocated to the 18th dynasty, who does correspond, actually, in terms of length of reign to Hatshepsut's. And that's interesting, because Manetho is notoriously unreliable in detail. So on one hand, you've got the official king list omit Hatshepsut, but she would clearly not be entirely forgotten. So today, where does she stand? She's very famous today. There are biographies of her. Obviously, views about her vary wildly. What I've said here today is not anything specific, in the sense that you should not take anything I've said here to reflect a notion that people only saw, scholars see Hatshepsut in only one way. There are lots of different ways of looking at her, and how she tried to deal with this concept of kingship. I come back to a point earlier on that I made, that it's a mistake to try and believe that not only can we find a specific answer, but also that Hatshepsut herself had a specific answer for what she was trying to do. She was experimenting. She tried in a number of different ways. She was determined to show that she was predestined to be a king of Egypt, a ruler of Egypt. And she tried to find all the ways possible to show that she was preordained, that she was a daughter of Amun, that she was someone who could fill both the male and female identities of being a king. But she came up against that paradox, which was that she therefore had nowhere to go. She had no future to present Egypt. That was her inherent problem. But she seems to have been a good and sound ruler who kept the place stable, And when Thutmose III became king, it was a smooth accession and ended up being one of the longest and most successful rules in all of Egyptian history. And for that, Hatshepsut must be credited for that. Within all of it, though, we will always be a little confused, bewildered by exactly how it was that she managed on a day-to-day basis, how these people like Sen and Mut made it all work for her, what the real relationship was between her and this man, who was undoubtedly one of the most exceptionally creative, gifted individuals in Egyptian history, and how he positioned himself within Hatshepsut's orbit. That's something anybody can decide for themselves by looking at the evidence, whether we'll ever get to the truth, but probably almost certainly not. But there is Hatshepsut, who had established this remarkable reign for herself within the context of ruling alongside Thutmose III. She remains a very powerful individual down today, and I think it's very interesting that she is one of the few Egyptian rulers that is still a household name. And in many, well, perhaps not in every household, but she certainly deserves to be. She is one of those people who stands head and shoulders above the time in which she lived and will forever be a source of fascination about what she was really up to, what she really meant, what she really believed, and what she really wanted. Talk has really been almost entirely about Hatshepsut, which I suppose in a way is something she would have liked. After all, Hatshepsut was all about her. Hatshepsut was obsessed with the idea that she was entitled to rule, that she was the daughter of Amun. She had built everything around this core relationship with her father, Thutmose I, and she had sought to make sure that everything was there to advertise her entitlement to be in charge of Egypt. And that's where we have to pause and consider the reality of the Bronze Age superstate at that point in time. And this isn't a case of criticising Egypt for the sake of it, or even Hatshepsut, because that kind of absolutist totalitarian rule is normal for the period. And we have to bear that in mind. Hatshepsut, like all the other monarchs of the 18th dynasty, saw the whole of Egypt, its resources, foreigners, particularly in Hatshepsut's case, the punt expedition, saw the whole thing as being for their benefit and welfare. All the riches brought back from punt were not for the greater good of the Egyptian people, but for embellishing Hatshepsut's temple and enriching the elite, those people who were in her immediate orbit. The massive obelisks that were brought all the way up the Nile from Aswan, forth Hatshepsut to be erected at Karnak, they represented untold quantities of blood, sweat and tears on the part of the ordinary Egyptians and the slaves and the prisoners of war who were put to work in those quarries. Utterly back-breaking labour. People who we know from the graveyards at Akhenaten's city of Amarna over a century later were people who died young, often children, young adults, with bodies that were broken, literally, with fractures, damage, and also riddled with other issues like malnutrition and physical problems that guaranteed almost that they wouldn't get past their 25th or 30th birthdays. So let's not be any doubt about Hatshepsut. It's too easy to be beguiled to stand in front of her temple, Deir el-Bahari, and be overcome with wonder at the glory of what this all was once. But no, you see that. Because we see these great monuments, it's very easy to be carried along by something that Hatshepsut wanted, which was to be beguiled by her and her importance. But the truth is for Egypt is that the entire thing is built on untold lives that we know nothing about and never will. And all that effort essentially was ultimately, I suppose you could say, to be harsh, it was wasted. Because all that labour, digging out her tomb, KV20, for example, this incredibly deep tomb in the Valley of the Kings. It's extraordinarily deep, may even have been intended originally to go all the way under the cliffs and reach down to a subterranean chamber below her temple at Deir el-Bahari. It beggars belief, the torture that that must have been for the people who dug it out. All of that done, and the temple and all its statues, and a lot of it subsequently destroyed with the obliteration of Hatshepsut's name. So let's not be naive about this. Egypt was a ruthless totalitarian state. On one hand, it was capable of creating the most remarkable monuments, but the price paid by ordinary Egyptians was colossal. And Hatshepsut is just as responsible for that as other rulers of the 18th dynasty, and in some ways, more.